Okay, this is the part two of the series. Now, what do we do? We talked about the problem. Now, let's talk about the solution. What can we do to come together economically to start rebuilding our lives as individuals and our communities and putting our families back together again? Because we're in a dire situation here. We're at ground zero. So we need to reverse the trend that we talked about earlier in order to rebuild a strong nation. This is a University in Your Home .org presentation. .org. You need to change that to .org. University, no. This is a University in Your Home.com. It's powered through unity.org. University in Your Home.com is where our portals are. That once you become a member, you'll be directed to that website there. All right, it's designed to have lectures and presentations that will help to rebuild and to intellectualize your life and give you the tools that you need. And for $40 a month, it's not $40,000 a year, so you need to get out of the habit of having to pay such an enormous amount of money and being in debt the rest of your life in order to get a quality education. And once I remember mentioned before, when I was in law school, most of it is self-study. A lot of times you study and learn information. You don't get a certificate from a university or anything like that. But we will give you a certificate for your own personal growth and development. And once we go through that, we'll talk about, we'll touch about Excel, spreadsheet development, so forth. Right now, let's not get ahead of ourselves. You can go to the website, powerthroughunity.org, and go to the University in Your Home series and see the curriculum there. $40 a month, strengthen the whole family. It's not $40,000 a year, even though, and with this information, and go to a regular university, you take a lot of courses fragmented, but this is concise thought process. So this is real world education. Give you the information and tell you how to use the information in your life. So it all goes together. And these are, it helps you us to basically start a business. We start our business, people want to fill out forms, do a business plan. There's more to just filling out the forms. You have to understand the logic and the theory that goes along with that information. All right, but right now we're going to talk about this universityofhome.com presentation. We're going to talk about the program that we have and how it works and how you can use it to educate yourself and make money. And it's a social, economic, spiritual, political construct that's designed to be a complete economic system to help us to get out of this conundrum that we're in. Remember the previous presentation that something phenomenon has to occur in order to break you out of those chains. And this is the phenomenon that is occurring. Welcome to Developing a Millionaire's Mindset. What is the secret to financial success? Find a product or service the world needs. Convince them they can't do without it. Then they will give you their money. Let's develop a millionaire mindset by developing a product the world needs. This is a business opportunity which will create new millionaires. Did you know that the U.S. government is a business? Did you know that your home is a business? And like any business, your home needs to generate a positive cash flow. So doesn't it make sense to turn your homes into a profitable business? If not, we will continue to be broke, homeless, and depending on charity to fund our dreams. Breaking news. U.S. poverty rate rises to 15.1%, highest since 1993. 50 million Americans at the poverty level, last count on food stamps. How do we change our social and economic destiny? How do we get our children out of gangs, prison, and foster care and change generational curses? Turn our men back into men and our women into women. We know the problems, so it's time to change. In November 2012, the U.S. Census Bureau and more than 16% of the population lived in poverty in the United States, including almost 20% of American children, up from 14.3%, approximately 43.6 million in 2009, and to its highest level since 1993. In 2008, 13.2%, 39.8 million Americans lived in poverty. There were about 643,000 sheltered and unsheltered homeless people nationwide in January 2009. Almost two-thirds stayed in an emergency shelter or transitional housing program, and the other third were living on the street in an abandoned building or another place not meant for human habitation. And this is 2013, so we wonder how far worse it's gotten. And we see the trend developing, so we have to take substantial action to stop it and reverse it. Where is the money? Do you know that African Americans have tremendous spending power? Black buying power, recession, and resiliency. Despite the severe impact of the Great Recession, Black's economic clout continues to energize the U.S. consumer market. The Ceiling Center estimates that the nation's Black buying power will continue its dramatic rise, $316 billion in 1990 to $600 billion in 2000 to $947 billion in 2010 to $1.34 trillion in 2012 and a projected $1.3 trillion in 2017. $1.3 billion. My goodness. This is consumer spending. This is not saving or investments. This is consumer spending. An opportunity to manage economic business cycles. Look at the chart. If we manage our wealth, we can take advantage of economic swings when the economy goes into distress. A buying opportunity. See, information is one thing, but unless you use the information properly, it is of no value to you. U.S. buying power statistics by race. Percent change in buying power. This is spending your money. And you will see earlier why other races are making more money, because we've given them all our money. And I mentioned before, it's like a man going to work all week, and he comes. He gets paid $100 and he comes home and he only has $2 because he's used his money and spent it and given it to everybody else except for his family. He comes home, the wife is going to be mad, the kid's hungry, and the rent can't be paid. The relationship will not last long. And that's what we do to each other as a nation. We give everybody else our money, but when it comes to us, we have none left. So we're looking at the chart from 1990 to 2000, the red, yellow, and black, the red, the maroon color of the total spending, white consumer spending, black consumer spending. Then we look at from 2000 to 2010, 2010 to 2012, and we still spend. Outspend everyone else in consumer spending. Make the less and spend the most. The nation's largest consumer markets, 2012, billions of dollars. New York, Texas, California, Florida, Georgia, Maryland, North Carolina, Illinois, Virginia, New Jersey. This is Black buying power. That's not a positive thing. You know, we have buying power, but we need to start saving and investing with each other. Black buying power, we started saving and investing with each other. Study. Black wealth growing, but still a ways to go. Black Americans are earning more than ever, but a lack of investment experience and conflicting attitudes towards saving stand in the way of accumulating wealth. Consumer advocates and experts say, Deborah Lee, president of Black Entertainment Television, discusses the report. Most times a black family that makes a good household income gets trapped into accumulating the symbols of success rather than recycling those assets to generate more assets, said Dale Bryant, 34, owner of the Bryant Group Investment House in New York. Several critical factors account for the gains in black buying power. Beyond population growth and inflation, one of the most important and enduring forces is the increasing number of blacks starting and expanding their own businesses. The 2007 survey of business owners, released by the U.S. Census Bureau in June 2011, shows the number of black-owned firms grew 61% in just the 5 years from 2002 to 2007, more than three times the gain in the number of all U.S. firms, 18%. That's good news. Also compared to the previous five-year period, the overall rate of growth in the number of black-owned firms accelerated, as did the rate of growth in the number of all U.S. firms. Between 2002 and 2007, the receipts of black-owned firms grew by 55% compared to the 34% increase in the receipts of all U.S. firms. We're moving in the right direction. Still another positive factor driving the group's buying power is its steadily rising levels of educational attainment, which should allow proportionally more blacks to enter occupations with ever higher average salaries. Census data show that the percent of blacks 25 and older who have completed high school or college rose from 66% in 1990 to 79% in 2000 and to 84% in 2010. Also, the 2010 current population survey indicates that 20% of blacks had a bachelor's degree, graduate, or professional degree. The percentage of blacks who had completed college in 2010, 20%, was higher than in either 2000, 17%, or 1990, 11%. Favorable demographic trends help too, since the black population continues to grow more rapidly than the total U.S. population. From 2000 to 2012, the nation's black population grew by 16% versus 7.6% for the white population and 12.2% for the total population. From 2012 to 2017, the black population is projected to grow by 6.9%, exceeding the 5.7% growth estimated for the total U.S. population. Also, the black population is younger. The 2010 current population survey put the median age of blacks at 31.4 years compared to 38.2 years for the white population and 36.7 years for the total population. Indeed, nearly 30%, 29.4, of all of the black population is under 18 years old versus 23.3% of whites and 24.6% of the total population. And they got us broke down into statistics. They study everything about us. Because blacks are so much younger, it's no surprise that they're increasingly setting trends for youth and young adults of every race and ethnic background. It sounds like some good news here. The youthful profile of the black population does have its downside, however. Compared to the people who are either more established in their careers or retired, young people, regardless of their race or ethnicity, are more exposed to job losses and economic downturns. In this regard, black buying power is vulnerable to the effects of economic recessions. But over time, the above-average growth of black buying power has more than compensated for that high cyclical exposure. Due to the unusual severity of the Great Recession, employment growth can no longer be cited as one of the main forces behind the above-average gains in black buying power. From January 2000 through January 2012, the most recent data available as of this writing, the number of jobs held by blacks had increased by only 235,000, or paltry 0.1% per year. And from its pre-recession peak in July 2007 but blacks held 16,307,000 jobs. Through January of 2012, when blacks held 15,512,000 jobs, the number of employed African Americans dropped by 795,000, representing an unemployment rate of 14.2%, up from 8.9% in July 07. In January of 2012, the employment-to-population ratio for blacks stood at only 52.2% versus 59.3% in July 2007. You know, we're it's skewed. That's why we need to concentrate. That's why this program is concentrating on creating businesses. The jobs, use the cash flow from the jobs to invest in businesses, recycle your money in the community through the businesses, and that way you create a vicious cycle. So, because we know a job, you can't inherit that job, you can't pass it on to your children. So, jobs aren't forever. You don't see the layoff rate there. So, at least by investing in businesses in the community and creating an economic infrastructure in the community, now you have a bridge to cross. So, when you're not working in corporate America, then you can work in your community. And you have opportunities there as well for your children and yourself. This recession was the worst since the Great Depression, and it erased a decade's worth of job growth for African Americans. At the time of this writing, it appears that the period of job losses is over, but the labor market is recovering very slowly, especially in states hit hardest by the housing bust. In 2012, the 10 states with the largest African-American markets in order are New York, Texas, California, Florida, Georgia, Maryland, North Carolina, Illinois, Virginia, and New Jersey. Of these, Maryland, North Carolina, and Georgia are the only ones that did not rank among the top 10 markets for all consumers. That means spending money, consuming, buying things, instead of investing in it and creating business opportunities. Unlike the Hispanic and Asian markets in the U.S., the African-American market is not concentrated in a handful of states. This vibrant consumer market is very widespread, making it an attractive customer segment in many of the states. So they're going after our money. So you got the increase in job. Look at the statistics here. You have the increase in businesses. We have jobs and economic potential. So now we got to start investing that money in black businesses and growth. And my job here is to make sure that these black businesses are proficient, efficient, and they qualify to do what they need. And also the consumer portion, start educating. Use a portion of that money to educate yourself financially. So that way we can create a true economic powerhouse. See, the ingredients aren't here, we just have to mix it properly. Due to differences in per capita income, wealth, demographics, educational attainment, occupational distribution, geographic distribution, and culture, the spending habits of blacks as a group are not the same as those of non-black consumers, white and other races combined. Thus, as African Americans' share of the nation's total buying power expands, business-to-consumer firms can be expected to devote more resources towards developing and marketing products that meet the needs and match the preferences of black consumers. They're out there trying to get your money. We have to be smarter than that. And they know they come up with these gimmicks and stuff, and we go for it. We got to be thinkers. Deborah Lee, president of Black Entertainment Television, discusses the report. Most times a black family that makes a good household income gets trapped into accumulating the symbols of success rather than recycling those assets to generate more assets. I set up a company to help wage earners, said Dale Bryant, 34, and most do not make it because of their attitudes towards money, said Bryant, who worked for high-end clients at Lehman Brothers before starting his own firm in 1996 for black investors. I have many clients with household incomes over $150,000 struggling to save $200 per month. Deborah Lee, president of Black Entertainment Television, says having extra money to save is uncharted territory for many black Americans. This may be the first generation of Black Americans who are able to accumulate wealth, Lee said. The community just needs to focus on it more. Whatever the reason, a report released Thursday found that Black household incomes are growing faster than wealth for those households.